Hallelujah, Jesus. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah.
Lord, you want to put the offering, please?
In case you didn't get them, there are notes on the back there. There's last week's page and this week's page.
Actually, yes.
Okay, just before I go any farther, in case I forget, I don't know if on the back of your green page.
No. There's no page two.
I was just going to say, you want to mark number two on the back of the page. Somebody thought he'd try to make it nice and orderly, that when you play your notebooks, you have page one, you look at, oh, there's page three, where it's supposed to be. But then if you go back over your notes in the future, or if I go to teach it again, you might realize, where's page two, and go looking for it, and think you don't have page two. What do I do with it? So, if you want to mark a two on the back of page one, then you know what's going on. Also, if you're wondering why is page one printed on a green piece of paper, is there any significance? There is a significant reason why it is green. It is because the person doing the copy forgot to take the green paper out of the copy. But we've been looking, shifting gears, and we're looking at what does it mean to be a Pentecostal powerhouse. And we asked a bunch of questions last week as we opened up it to lead into the series. And we started asking about what would make our church different from any other church. We asked what rapidly grew the early church. And then we also ask why we don't see signs and wonders real briefly. When we talk about a Pentecostal powerhouse, what do I have in my mind's eye? I think about somebody who's constantly at the gym working out. What are they doing? They're working their muscles. They're making them stronger. They're getting leaner. They're making others maybe more distinct. They're getting toned. When it comes to working out, who's the main individual in the process?
We are.
So-and-so can't go to the gym and work out for you and have it work for you and have you gain the benefits. Mommy and daddy can't work and work and work and just hand everything over all the time to you. Especially when we get older, we have our own bills and our own houses. Unfortunately, normally it doesn't work that way. When it comes to the physical, if we are going to get in shape, we are the ones that have to work out. It is our responsibility. No one else can do it for us. So when it comes to the spiritual, guess who has to do the one to get in shape spiritually? Who has to put the effort in? Who has to put the time in? We do. When it comes down to practically everything in life, you know, it's our decision. What we're going to eat. How we're going to maintain our body.
Is Dad here?
No. Okay.
So I can get away with this story. So my dad has diabetes. So I had a question for him the other week or month or whatever it was. So I said, Dad, would you come up and take a look at this? And for most people that know me, I'm a wheeler and dealer with some things. I'll try and make a buck where I can. Walmart doesn't pay enough. I need a raise, a big one, regardless. So I'll wheel and deal. He walks into my office and I have 18 cases of peanut butter eggs sitting in my office, just sitting there. And he goes in, doesn't tell anybody, and I look in, and he's peeking inside one of the boxes. I said, Dad, if you want one, you can just take one. Just take the taste. No, 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 no. But whose responsibility was it? If he's going to try keeping sugar in check and everything else, whose responsibility is to make sure that he's eating properly? It's his. We can't control him. We can't make him. It's his. I remember my mom when she was alive. If she wanted an extra sweet, she also had diabetes. She'd take an extra shot of insulin. We do what we want. We are in control of our own bodies. If somebody has high blood pressure, they might try and regulate a diet so that they can bring down the blood pressure. I mean, there are many numerous examples we can use. But the point of the matter of every single one is, when it comes down to the end, the person who holds the decision is theirs. No one can make it for you. No one can force you to eat a certain way. No one can make you keep your body in check or do the things you're supposed to be doing. If you want to get in shape physically, it is your responsibility. No one else can do it for you. The same is true when it comes to our spiritual life. You know, the pastor can get up and preach every week, but if it falls on deaf ears or it falls on stony ground, guess what? The word might not take root. Whose fault is it? It's ours. If we're not reading our Bible every day like we're supposed to, mommy, daddy, our wife, our husbands, whoever it might be, daughters, sons, they can't do it for us. It is our responsibility. Now, can we have anyone encourage us when it comes to working out? Absolutely. I mean, there are people that will have workout partners, and they'll take people with to encourage them and have to check up on them. They might go to the gym at the same time. They might try and hold them accountable. But at the end of the day, even your workout partner or your accountability partner, they can't make you do what you're supposed to do. If we are going to walk with God, if we're going to become a quote-unquote Pentecostal powerhouse, it's not the pastor's responsibility. It's not the Sunday school's responsibility, teacher's responsibility. It's not your spouse's responsibility or anybody else. It all comes down to you. If I want to become spiritually fit or grow closer to God, Beth can't make me, mom and dad can't make me, pastor can't make me. It is my responsibility, mine and mine alone. No one can make us grow in faith. No one can make us practice the gifts of the Spirit. No one can make us seek for the baptism of the Holy Ghost with evidence of other tongues, and et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. There's only one individual that can make us do those things. And when you look in the mirror, you're looking exact right back at them. Sister Brother, we get ready to hand these out, please. We're going to take a 5-minute questionnaire. Maybe not even that long. I don't know if everybody, does everybody have a pen?
Yeah.
But like I said, when it comes to becoming spiritually fit, it's no one else's responsibility but our own. No one can force us to do it. No one can make us step outside of our comfort zone. It's only us. The Holy Ghost can draw us, but we still must make the decision. Right now, Sister Beth is handing out a quick questionnaire. We're not going to make them public. But we're just going to take a moment to answer these questions. I have used this on a Tuesday night here recently. Thank you. what's the point of this questionnaire? Point is, as we're getting ready to lead into this new series, as we've already stated, no one can make us grow spiritually. No one can force us closer to God. It has to be our decision. And sometimes the desires aren't always there. But sometimes when we look back in retrospect, our eyes are open. God, I need more of you. God, I need you to work with me in this area. What's the purpose of these questionnaires? To hopefully make us hungry for more of the things of God. Maybe where we once desired to see the things of God, or desired to go deeper in God, maybe we slacked off a little bit. But we're getting ready to have an open discussion on why don't we see signs and wonders happening anymore. So as we get ready to go into that, the questionnaire begins with, have you ever seen a miracle? And did God use you in performing the miracle? The Bible states that signs and wonders will follow them that believe. In John chapter 14, verses 12 and 13, verily, verily, I say unto you, he that believeth on me the works that I do, shall he do also, and greater works than he should, than these shall he do, because I go to my Father. And whatsoever you shall ask in my name, that will I do, that the Father may be glorified in the Son. So have you ever seen a miracle? It's one thing to see a miracle, but did God use you to bring that miracle back? Now that makes it a little bit more personal. Because if God's going to use us, that means we need to be a willing vessel. God will use whoever is willing. You know, there's a phrase that's going around, and it's been for years, but God doesn't call the qualified. He qualifies the called. Why? A, it brings a sense of humility because, God, that wasn't me. I can't do that in my own strength. And B, it brings us to a state of humility even within ourselves because it's just a sense of that God of the universe was willing to allow me to be a vessel that he could be used for. It's one thing to see something happen. It's another thing to allow us to be the vessel that God chooses. Have you ever seen God interfere with nature to perform a miracle? And did God use you to perform the miracle? I've heard of a woman where a tornado was coming directly from her house. And she prayed. You know, that tornado hit all the houses around her in a straight line. But jumped over her house and then just went on its path. You know, she allowed God to use her in prayer. Perhaps she allowed the Holy Ghost to pray through her for what she didn't understand. Have you ever seen someone healed miraculously? I remember in Bible school we would have in our opening banquet for the second semester. Is that right? Yeah, second semester. And a girl in her class that fell down the steps and her ankle, who was walking on crutches, had someone pray for her. And she, next thing you know, she takes off running throughout the bottom of the building there. No. Have you ever seen God heal someone right in front of you? And were you the individual that was praying for them when they were healed? Did you ever see anyone deliver from demon possession? And if so, did God use you to cast them out? When we think about these things, they seem pretty grand, pretty large. Instantaneous healing, or maybe even progressive healing, but a miraculous healing nonetheless, because not all healing is instantaneous. Sometimes it takes a little while. But nonetheless, have we ever been involved in any of these? Have we been involved in the praying process? Now, whatsoever you shall ask in my name, that will I do, that the Father may be magnified and glorified. The Bible says that greater things than these shall you do when talking to concerning the works of Jesus Christ. If nothing else, it should be a challenge for us this morning already that we have a desire to draw closer to God, that we desire to be used of Him. We are living in a world full of quote-unquote Christians, but how many are willing to be used of God? How many are close enough to really, truly be used of God? And in order to do that, sometimes we have to get the mind of God as well. I'm not sure, we'll talk about it throughout the series, probably at some point, but I go back to the revival of Hebrides Island, where Duncan Campbell in his sermon, When God Sat Down, talks about how the minister was called to preach there, but there was a little old woman in that church that knew the secrets of God. The minister didn't, but she did. And one day she came to him and said, Minister, you need to go to such and such town. Did God speak to him? No. But that woman was close to God, and she knew the secrets of God, and God talked to her. We need to have a hunger and a desire to draw closer to God than ever before. If we're going to become a spiritual powerhouse, Pentecostal powerhouse, guess what it begins? With us desiring more of God and getting closer to Him. And the more that we hunger and thirst and closer that we get, we can get close to God, but then we also need to take a step outside of our comfort zone. If we are ever going to see anything happen, if we're ever going to see signs and wonders, we're going to have to step outside of our comfort zones. And before I go any farther, we're going to present with you the question. Why do you think that we do not see signs and wonders happen today? And when I say that, or at least on a low scale, why don't we see really signs and wonders happening anymore?
They're not looking for it.
They're not looking for it?
Unbelief.
Unbelief. I won't disagree with you at all, brother. Anything else? Why don't you think that we see signs and wonders happen really anymore?
We don't believe in them.
We don't believe in them, but I think there's a little bit more to it, brother. I really do. And it falls into the same category, I'm sure. But
in prayer.
In prayer.
Prayer is the secret of miracle.
I don't disagree with you, brother, but can we also say, is it safe to say that there are people that are close to God and walk with God, have a daily walk, but they don't see signs and wonders in their life? They should, but is it safe to say that not all of them do? And if so, why don't they see signs and wonders? Why do we not see signs and wonders hardly anymore? You know, if we went down to the early church and looked at the book of Acts, we see signs and wonders all over. If we went back to the early days of Pentecost here in America in the early 1900s, we saw signs and wonders. There was a woman by the name of Amy McPherson who said that she probably saw tens of hundreds, let me make sure I get this right, tens of thousands possibly healed under her ministry. We go back to the 1940s, 1950s, Jack Hope ministry of healing, where people instantaneously got healed. And not just one or two or three, but lots of people got healed under his ministry. There were healing ministries that went out during the 1940s and 50s, I think it was, that's what they were known for, that they saw signs and wonders happen. There's a church in Ohio called Broadway Assembly, whether or not they actually still have these up or not, but they used to have, whenever somebody was healed, if there was something to put on the wall, they put it on the wall. There were wheelchairs out there. There were crutches. There were canes. It was a testimony that someone got healed. Why don't we, if we go back to the early days of this church, there used to be a list of names and what people got healed from. Whatever happened to, I don't know, but there was a list. There is historical documentation that there was a list at one time kept of people who were miraculously healed in this church. But why do we not see signs and wonders in our world? When I say we, I mean the church as a whole. Disagree with you one bit, brother. I do think that's part of it as well. There's also part of us that we see bleed into every other area of our life as well. And I would say fear. Because we can have everything going just right. We can know exactly what to do. But we have to step outside of our comfort zone. And we get down and start thinking about ourselves. Do we really like stepping outside of our comfort zone? We don't know what people are going to think. We don't know how they're going to respond. To be honest, if we're unsure of something within ourselves, we're less likely to do it. It takes us longer to do it. I mean, even if we do that, the same thing normally in the natural, at least I do, it's taken me forever to drywall my house. Why? Because part of it is, I've never done it before. I wasn't sure how to go about it. And I'm all like, I hate sanity, so I'm not looking forward to the muddy process. But if we look in our own lives, if we're going to do something for the first time, how do we respond? Even though we may know everything to do just right, normally there's that sense of resistance because what about this? What about this? I've never done it before. So it's almost like you're already dragging your heels. And I think we do the same thing when it comes to signs and wonders. Because one thing is a lot easier in the church to be used of God versus outside of the church. Because practically everybody within here is pretty accepting. You know, you mess up in tongues or interpretation, or if you try, or if you feel God stepping out to talk to somebody and pray over, that's one thing. But what if God's telling you to step out and pray for somebody at Walmart? That's an entirely different situation. If you're praying over your brother or your sister for healing, what's your mentality when it comes to confidence level going to be versus praying for them in the church versus some random stranger outside that you don't know? Especially if we are praying for an instantaneous miracle. God, if you don't do this, I don't know what to do. So we have that sense of fear. As Brother Eli was talking about too. But there's also that sense, I believe, that people get a satisfaction. You know, it's very easy to come to church and just sit in the pew. It's very easy to walk with God when it comes to maybe our daily devotions, reading our Bible the way that we're supposed to. It's very easy to do those things at home and in those right environments, those environments that we're comfortable. But when we have to step outside of our comfort zone, then things start getting shady, if you will. What if God doesn't move? What if God doesn't work? If there's some man walking through Walmart maybe with a withered arm or a withered hand, and you feel the Holy Ghost prompting you to pray for that individual, that that hand be completely restored. What are the odds that if somebody was in the church for you to pray for them versus that you'd be with the same amount of willing to do it outside? We get satisfied. We get fear. as Brother Eli was talking about earlier, there's that sense of doubt that sometimes come over us as well. If we talk about doubt, what does God say about prayer and faith in the book of James? And I'm jumping around a little bit. James chapter 1, verses 5 through 8. James 1, 5 through 8, if someone will please read that.
Man, you lack wisdom in the best of God, that gives to all men liberally and operated love, and it shall be given them. But let him ask in faith, nothing wavering, for he that wavers is like a wavered sea driven with the wind and calm. For let not man that think that he shall receive anything of the Lord, if God Almighty can and save him all his ways.
So when right here James is writing concerning two different topics, faith, and he's talking about prayer. He said, let him ask of God, and what does he conclude that phrase with?
He gives all men liberally.
Let him ask God with nothing, nothing wavering.
Faith and
believe. I want to focus there where he talks about in faith and nothing wavering. So he said, if we ask in faith, we'll have it. But if we waver, we'll go back. Lord God, will you do it? Won't you do it? We're not asking in confidence. We are double-minded. And when we look at the Word of God, and I don't have the reference here, Jesus actually rebuked the disciples for not praying to God with confidence. And of course, I don't have it in these notes. I have them in other notes that I copy and paste from. But the double-minded man has no surety, no precision. When we look at the Word of God as well, Jesus told us that we ought to be like little children. If you tell a child something, do they believe it? Do they have any questions about it? They do have questions? Well, I'm not talking about the million and one questions, but if you tell them that after supper they're going to have a cookie, they might ask, when's supper? When can I have the cookie? But do they doubt at all that they're going to get the cookie? Do they question that what you told them you're going to do for them or give them, do they have any question that it might not come to pass? Do they have any doubt? No. They believe what you've told them. When we look,
well, in Romans, there's a verse that says, and he that doubteth is damned, if he eat, because he eateth not of faith. For whatsoever is not of faith is sin.
So we have to have faith. And we're going to talk about a little faith a little bit. I'm pulling faith apart a little bit, brother.